from Rio de Janeiro to Kampala. What lessons has Uganda learned to protect the environment and also deal with emerging challenges that are frustrating sustainable development? At a recent conference on climate change held in Brazil's Rio de Janeiro, the world recommitted itself to dealing with critical issues that are destroying the environment, declaring they would work towards an environmentally friendly future. Uganda was part of this conference, and a delegation led by Water and Environment Minister Mariam Tagamba took part in formulating a vision for sustainable development with the environment at the forefront. At the same meeting, countries were urged to adopt the Green Economy Initiative if sustainable development and poverty reduction are to be attained. At this conference, as this conference was going on, an environmental disaster was happening in Buruta district, calling into question our own resolve as a country towards ensuring a sustainable development. The landslides in Buruta are simply one of the many climatic challenges Uganda faces today, with many other cases including flooding. Well, recently Kampala was in deep trouble over that. Indiscriminate deforestation, destruction of wetlands, and many others. One of the key challenges noted in the past is the failure to implement policies of government and decisions taken at international conferences where Uganda has participated. So tonight we look at the decisions taken at the Rio Plus 20 climate, as they called it, to try and understand how Uganda will take them forward. We'll also look at the challenges that make sustainable development still a mystery in this country. Our guests tonight, Mr. Eugene Muramira, Director of Policy Planning and Information at NEMA. You must welcome Mr. Muramira.
Thank you, and good evening, listeners and viewers.
Viewers, because we're also on the internet, YouTube, you can get a spectrum video. We're also joined by Mr. Geoffrey Kamese, Senior Program Officer in charge of Energy, Climate Change, and Chemical Management. You must welcome Mr. Kamese.
Thank you, and good evening, and good evening, viewers and listeners.
Mr. Muramira, can you give us a background on what was discussed in Rio de Janeiro?
Oh, thank you. Rio Plus 20 was a follow-up conference to the initial Rio Summit of 1992. And purposely, the objective of the follow-up conference was to renew political commitment. And to that point, several heads of government and states were expected and did turn up. The purpose also was to assess progress across the globe towards sustainable development, and the countries were in the process tasked to account on how much they've done towards attaining sustainable development against the commitments they made in Rio de Janeiro in 1992, but also at the World Summit on Sustainable Development in Johannesburg in 2002. The other objective of the conference was to build consensus and agree on how to transition to a green economy in the context of sustainable development and poverty education. And the listeners and viewers will have opportunity to interact and get to know exactly what the green economy concept is. The theme of the conference was shaping the future we want, moving towards a prosperous, secure, and sustainable world. There was a lot of discussion, of course, with a lot of contests and the arguments, particularly between the developed world, who are usually on the other side, and us in the framework of the Group of 77. I think that's reasonable background to the conference. Maybe the other things is that the Honorable Minister of Water and Environment, Honorable Mariam Tagamba, led the Ugandan delegation.
Yes.
We missed His Excellency the President. This was a big delegation, a powerful delegation, with the sector ministries also represented. There are quite a lot of issues around energy, so we had the Honorable Minister for Energy, responsible for energy, Honorable Muloni. We had some members of parliament. In fact, the Deputy Speaker of Parliament was present in person, and various technical officers.
All right. And how relevant were the outcomes to Uganda specifically?
Well, we'll touch on that, but briefly. Maybe I can just mention some of the key discussion clusters against which we measure the outcomes. One cluster was on, as I've mentioned already, framing the context for the green economy and developing the requisite measurement mechanisms or indicators to see whether when we agree to transition to a green economy, we are doing it. There have been issues around the global institutional framework for sustainable development, the issues of really how we get an institution to help and lead us in integrating in a balanced way the environmental, social, and economic pillars of sustainable development. Many countries have failed, I hope we are not on the same route, to balance these three pillars. You find some countries emphasize the economy usually because voting is marked against that, while at the same time they are pressing the other pillars, the social, environmental. There was also an issue around the means of implementation, the issues of financing, the issues of technology transfer, and so on. As part of the outcomes, and which was also an issue for discussion, was the Millennium Development Goals and the moving away to a more ambitious means of measurement or targets, which they called sustainable development goals. There was a lot of discussion around the fact that the Millennium Development Goals were relevant to countries that have stagnated in poverty, because as you know, the first goal is about eradicating extreme, and mark the word extreme, poverty and hunger. And people are arguing we cannot continue measuring our performance against such a minimalistic indicator. So we need to have something that portrays us as moving forward.
All right.
The other one quickly was the issue of sustainable consumption and production that generated a lot of discussion. And then, of course, the normal things of biodiversity and forests, of chemicals, and so on and so forth. In terms of agreement, I think at a later stage I will explain each one of these discussion clusters and how the outcomes mapped out as the conference progressed.
All right. Well, listeners, this is Spectrum on Radio 1 tonight from Rio de Janeiro to Kampala. What lessons has Uganda learned to protect the environment and also deal with emerging challenges that are frustrating sustainable development? Our guest, Mr. Eugene Muramira, Director of Policy Planning and Information at NEMA, and Mr. Geoffrey Kamese, Senior Program Officer in charge of Energy, Climate Change, and Chemical Management at the National Association of Professional Engineers. Is that my right?
Environmentalists.
You're most welcome once again. Can you talk to us about your own expectations? Did you find what you expected to find at Rio?
Yeah, I think we went with a lot of expectations, like we usually do. But indeed, something was good, but a lot still remains yet to come. As usual, we saw a divide between the poor and the rich, and there was that kind of hide and seek kind of scenario where the poor were demanding and the rich were saying we can stretch to this level and we can't go beyond this. And of course, the other thing is that the issue of economics, the issue of resources, the issue of maximizing profits still was at play. Of course, when you look at some good outcomes, of course, when they say we want sustainable energy for all, that is good. All our people need energy. But what kind of energy are we going to get? And how does this translate to a poor person in a rural setup? Those are some of the issues that remain at question, because while we are surely welcoming the energy for all, we are also mindful that there are some of our people who are coming, instead of helping us, they are coming to exploit us. So those are some of the challenges. Then there is an initiative that also was launched at these talks, the Zero Hunger. Of course, that is a very wonderful initiative, but what kind of zero hunger are we expecting? Do we really think that our people are going to be empowered? You see, from a civil society perspective, we do not only look at people getting food, but we need the food to be controlled by the people themselves, to get the food and be able to feed themselves, and not to be always on a demanding side. Somebody has the food and he supplies you what he feels he can supply you. So there are a lot of issues that came out, which as civil society welcome, but there are several issues that are still of contentious in nature. And we have also, as I said, there is a new term that as civil society we are becoming concerned about.
Yes.
Financialization of nature. Everybody looking at nature in terms of the money. Exactly. And somebody does not think, for example, if it rains, how much money can you attach to that kind of rain? Somebody will not calculate for you how much a community, for example, that benefits from medicinal plants save in terms of money. So there is this issue of thinking that our resources can only be best evaluated in terms of cash, in terms of dollars, and that is where for us as civil society we are becoming concerned. And of course there is this new phenomena that has come up, which is also going to rob us of a lot of our resources, the issue of private-public partnership. They could be good, but there is this thinking that a businessman will always think business. He is not there to provide or to do charity. So if you are thinking you as a private, public, you are going to enter into joint venture with a business-oriented person, the possibility that you mutually benefit is at doubt. So we are a bit, as civil society, concerned that there are a lot of new things that are coming that may, at the end of it all, not benefit us as citizens, but end up reaping us of our resources. Of course, in all these, I must say it, when you talk about Rio, talk about it in terms of governments going, but also business communities going. So they are looking at business opportunities. They are pressing and wanting to get out as much as they can, because a successful Rio summit to a businessman will be evaluated in how much business he has been able to attract from such a kind of meeting. So from our civil society perspective, those are our worries. We are not against the business people, but we are also mindful of what impact these businesses could have on our people. We have not seen yet a business that is actually pro-poor.
Oh, you haven't seen even one?
No.
You sure about this?
Yes, I'm sure. Which business is it? Talk about a clinic.
Some people make soap and it's used by the poor.
Soap?
Some make pharmaceuticals.
You think somebody can make soap at no profit? He would never. Pharmaceuticals, that is a very good business. You go to some of these clinics, they are very good businesses while they are serving the poor, but the business, the profit part of it is also involved. So those are some of our kind of fears, but we are very, very grateful that the meeting talked about real issues that affect the people.
Right.
And if really it was not not looked from the business perspective and looked in terms of helping the poor, helping our communities, conserving our environment, using it in a more sustainable manner, I think we would be very grateful as civil society.
And of course, if you're going to help the poor, you need to have some money in the first place. Some much of it is going to come from profit, but that's a debate probably for another time and place, maybe. Let's talk about, in your view, Mr. Kamese, how is Uganda adequately, how is Uganda compliant to these international standards?
No, I think for example, in terms of implementing Agenda 21, initially there was a lot of effort, there were a lot of programs, and I would say some of them were really successful. But eventually I think we reached somewhere we started losing the way, and the business part of it took over. And when business takes over, then the issue, for example, when you look at sustainable development, it talks about business, yes, but it talks about natural resources. What is use of natural resources? I wouldn't imagine that we have been using our natural resources in a more wise way. That's why some of the problems that you mentioned come up, because we are emphasizing, we are leaning towards one side at the expense of the other. So in a nutshell, I would say that we started well, but along the way we started diverting from the rightful path. And at the moment, unless we go back to our drawing board and we decide to agree to balance our development with the sustainable use of our resources, that will be something that we could maybe achieve in future. But also the other challenge,
yes,
where we are likely not to attain sustainable development,
yes,
is we are exporting a lot of our raw materials.
Like which ones?
You mention all the minerals that you talk about. Gold is mined.
Where do you want the gold to go?
Now,
you have a market for it.
Let me tell you, all these countries that are developed did not develop by exporting their raw materials. I don't think there is any that you will tell me that Britain exported its raw materials and eventually it developed, now it is re-importing. It started by utilizing the raw materials that were there and utilized them effectively, and they attained some degree of development. For us, when we have eventually exhausted our resources, where are we going to import from?
All right. Mr. Muramira, where are some of the areas where this country falls short on these international standards?
Well, but I must make a few clarifications
on
the submission by my old boy.
Please do.
Interestingly, Mr. Kamese is my OB at Kabalega School.
Right.
In Masindi. He pointed out a number of critical issues, only that maybe somewhere, somehow we might disagree. The first issue, which was a bit last, is the issue of profit. Profit is not equivalent to sin. I don't know which religion my brother here professes, but I think profit is not a bad thing. But the point I would note from his submission on private-public partnerships is the way it came out at Rio, that a lot of emphasis was put on channeling resources for sustainable development through public-private partnerships. And you know what that means? That if development partners are to give us assistance, they could use their companies to come over here.
Multinational companies?
Yes, or national companies, actually, in their countries, which de-emphasizes direct development assistance, which is government to government, where you as countries have more flexibility to manage the resources and plan for them. but also of course retention of most of that of those resources back here, rather than giving you with one hand and taking away with another hand. I think that is an issue we should think about a bit more, rather than saying PPP is not
a give us a better scenario on that, a foreign company, foreign aid company.
Well, we can have a mix but with direct assistance and private public partnerships, because some of these companies bring with them technologies, so there's an inbuilt technology transfer. As you know, we don't have quite a lot of skilled people at certain levels. I'm not saying at many levels for that matter. So they come along with experts, and that could be helpful if we can utilize that channel very well. I think that is adequate for PPP, which actually was attached to the means of implementation and mostly technology transfer and funding. The other issue he pointed out and criticized is financialization of nature. I happen to be an environmental economist, and that is an area I like to talk about. The arguments and criticisms came around the discussion cluster on the framework, framing the context of the green economy, and developing the requisite indicators, which I mentioned earlier. And people, because within that cluster, some of the issues that came up were that we need to adopt and promote environmental accounting or resource accounting, whereby you should be able to put and valuation, resource valuation, where you should be able to track the economic and financial implications of some of the uses of our resources, but also pollution. In my view, if you talked about it as just financialization and the way some communities don't like to talk about money, it might sound bad. But basically, what this was talking about, green accounting, what it talks about, is that when you utilize your resources, like fish from Lake Victoria, you should be able to track the physical uptake of the fish, how much have you fished out, but you should also attach a money value and know that the value I'm withdrawing from the ecosystem or whatever is this amount, and then draw out the linkages. Where is this fish going? Is it all exported? Is it in local industry? Is it creating employment? And so on. When you do that, you are also able to track depletion issues, so that after you do your accounts, it's not you've taken away all the fish and depleted the resource and you were not aware. Many countries are tempted, for instance, to cut forests.
Yes.
Then the economy seems to be growing because there's a lot of action. And if you don't do green accounting, you will never detect the danger.
Green accounting is, yes?
Yeah, helps you to know how much the resource is contributing to the economy, but you also do some depreciation, inbuilt depreciation, to know and track that the resource is being exhausted, so that you plan for the future. I can give the other example, the other side, pollution. If you had, for instance, an oil spill, we are moving to that that area of economic management. Yes, there will be a lot of activity, cleaning up, and so on. And the Minister of Finance would ordinarily look at that as an improvement of the economy, because there will be payment of wages, hiring of machines, and so on. Now, for a green accountant, and which people are condemning as financialization, you must track all these transactions, look at the money implications, and draw out what we would call a balance sheet. Know whether that expenditure, as much as it reflects as an improvement in the economy, is on the positive side of the balance sheet, right, or on the negative. I honestly don't think that would be bad, although the whole idea of green accounting and the moving towards a green economy,
all right,
raised a lot of controversy in Rio.
Okay, well, listeners, this is Spectrum Radio, and tonight, from Rio de Janeiro to Kampala, what lessons has Uganda learned to protect the environment and also dealing with emerging challenges that are frustrating sustainable development? We're going for a break. We'll be back.
Remember, remember me because I tried.
Remember me, not for the moves I pull.
All the goals I scored. My dribbling, my passes on target.
My footwork, my tough defense.
Don't remember me for the score. For whether I won or lost. Remember me because I played. Because I laced up my boots.
And I stepped onto the pitch.
Remember me because I listened to the voice inside. And with everything in me,
I played.
As the Airtel Rising Stars tournament heats up, we are giving you the chance of a lifetime. Send ARS to 6333 and stand a chance to win a fully paid trip for two to the UK to watch a Premier League match. That's not all. You can win 1 million shillings, soccer balls daily, and 2.5 million shillings or a jersey of your favorite team every week. SMS ARS to 6333 and win with the Airtel Rising Stars.
Airtel. John, Mike and I, we go back a bit. We knew John at the beginning, working for someone else. But he was different. He had vision, saw opportunities. He started working towards his goal, opened his own garage, and worked, learning the hard way. His reputation spread. Trust, consistency, quality. Soon people were coming to him from all parts. He made himself and his whole street prosper and also helped friends, seeing potential in people and helping them on. But John never shouts about all his success. He's just who he is. Special.
So here's to men like John, who make a difference, who enjoy Nile Special, the rich, satisfying taste from the source. Nile Special. You've earned it.
Not for sale to persons under 18.
Spectrum on Radio 1 FM 90.
Welcome back to Spectrum Radio, and tonight from Rio de Janeiro to Kampala. What lessons has Uganda learned to protect the environment and also deal with emerging challenges that are frustrating sustainable development? Our guest tonight, Mr. Eugene Muramira, Director of Policy Planning and Information at NEMA, that's the National Environment Management Authority, it's a government body, and Mr. Geoffrey Kamese, Senior Program Officer in charge of Energy, Climate Change and Chemical Management at the Navy, that is the National Association of Professional Environmentalists. You will be able to call in and contribute to this discussion. Mr. Kamese, where has Uganda fallen short? We've heard about the floods in the city, landslides in the east. Where does Uganda fall short?
Yeah, I think the whole essence of sustainable use of natural resources is slipping away. While at the beginning we thought it wise as a country to put in place institutions that would kind of foresee on the sound management of these resources, even putting in place the laws and policies that would help these institutions to carry out their mandate, I think we reached somewhere, and we started stepping over some of these institutions and doing what we felt was maybe more economically viable, bypassing the laws that we are supposed to help in enforcing sustainable development. Now, where have we gone wrong? Look at the wetlands. Look at the forests. Move around the country.
Yes.
You will see that the rate at which our forests are going is quite alarming.
90,000 hectares every year.
That's the
equivalent of 3 Muramira forests.
Exactly. And I think Eugene is much more able to tell us how many years we have to have our forests ahead of
they
us.
They give the permits for the people who slash down the forest.
Not these ones. It is in NFA.
Nobody actually does that.
Then you look at the wetlands. The wetlands are going at a very alarming rate. And you know, I have moved around many cities. You don't just clean the city and just put their structures. Some of the water must be absorbed by the ground. But in our kind of situation, and let's expect even much more floods, because every water that will be raining will be running off to the valleys and causing a lot of havoc.
Right.
So you can't say that we are going to attain sustainable development in that kind of sense. Look at the fish.
But what if plant sugar cane in a certain place? There's no problem with that, is there?
No, because a sugar cane is not a tree. It is a grass, and therefore you can never say that you are replacing a tree with a forest.
So you think that is wrong thinking?
That is wrong. Of course, many people will say they are right, but I think it's wrong. And while you look at the jobs, but you lose the value of the medicines that you are getting. Even the rain, you cannot attach a cost on the rain that we get. So those are some of the things that...
Oh, when you cut down a forest, some of the rain that would fall, you won't see.
Exactly, that would be true. I one time happened to... I always use this example. I went to Palisand. I was raising awareness on wetland conservation. And the communities themselves were saying, we are seeing the lake running away. The lake was going away from them. And they would even tell you that beyond the wetland, the lake running away, we used to have a unique microclimate in this area that would help us grow plant A, plant B, plant C, but we are not seeing that happen. So when we lose some of these ecosystems, in the short term, we may not realize our loss, but as we continue going on with life,
it will come hitting us.
It comes hitting us.
Talk to us briefly about Bududa. How do you contextualize it in terms of
Bududa,
environmental use?
I think Bududa is all about deforesting the area, destroying the cover vegetation, and eventually exposing some of the, because some of these soils are held together by the roots of some of these
trees.
And when these
sugarcane want to do,
sugarcane will never. When these trees go away, of course, eventually, and of course, you don't only blame government. Even us as communities, we have a role that we have played.
So plant matoke.
Exactly. And all these eventually translate into the disasters that we are seeing. So when you look at, for example, our industries, chemicals, wastes that are untreated being discharged into our water bodies. The other time, National Water and Sewerage was saying our costs of running the plants are going high. Therefore, the water must also go high. Why is the cost going high? Because a lot of chemicals are going into these waters, and the waters must be treated. So
they have to push their pipes deeper into the lake.
So all these are not good indicators of us having performed well. So indeed, we have done a lot that has not gone the right way, and we need to sit down as a country. In fact, after receiving some of these outcomes from Rio, we need to sit down and say, how do we actualize? Because we have committed ourselves, how do we indeed actualize these commitments so that our people and our country can develop in the right direction?
All right, so you don't agree that sugarcane should replace any forest anywhere?
I wouldn't.
You
because I must tell you that the rate at which our forests have gone and the rate at which some of these calamities are happening. For example, look, me, I grew up knowing that if you have a tall tree somewhere, you would never get lightning striking you. Now the tall trees have all gone. Lightning is beginning to strike schools, strike buildings. All those are things that are happening that maybe would have avoided. I know I don't have a scientific proof of that, but I know my grandfather, my grandmother knew some of that science.
All right, so when the lightning strikes the children at school, it's not that God hates us, or it's not bad luck.
Never.
We'll cut the forest. There's nothing to hold to get the striking, the lightning, because the carbon in the trees absorbs a shock from the thunderbolts.
Yeah, exactly, because they tell you that, even by the way, when you look at the thunder lightning arresters,
yes,
they are tall and
looking
pointed.
Waiting for it higher.
Yes, at higher points. And when these higher... because me, I remember one time at school, a lightning struck a tree, and for us, we survived. So
it was absorbed by that tree.
Yes, it was absorbed
so
by the
plant
tree.
Plant sugarcane, you're in trouble. Mr. Muramira, talk to us about what Uganda can do to improve things. We've seen Bududa, we've seen Kampala flooding, and you say it's abuse of the environment. Where can we plug the loopholes?
Well, you see, the biggest challenge and cause of some of these things is poverty. And I'm glad that the conference in Rio identified poverty as the greatest enemy to the environment, so to say. And therefore, I think we need to strive as much as possible to improve the livelihoods of our people so that they can become, what is the word? They can become protectors rather than destroyers of the environment.
Yes. Poor people are more of a hazard to the environment.
Well, people have argued to the contrary sometimes, but the story on the ground is that really,
it is the
when you are eking out a living from, using the most rudimentary methods and the technologies and so on, in a collective way, you damage the environment.
So the poor are the enemies of the environment.
Poverty, maybe not the poor, but poverty is the greatest enemy of the environment.
And the rich are friends of them, but they never do wetlands.
Well, actually, when you look at the models drawn about some of these things, rich countries have better environments.
Now, let's talk about the individuals here at home.
Probably also, although we have a unique case in Kampala, where the rich people turn around and become the enemies of the environment. They are the ones degrading wetlands massively, although, of course, that doesn't exonerate some of our poor colleagues who have created the slums and the, shanties.
Poor people have created slums.
In wetlands, yes. There are many examples. You go to this place next to Bugolobi, Namuongo, Kitintalis, and so on. And sometimes you pity them. They keep getting pushed from one point, they move to the next one, which means I think our physical planners, our city authorities have to look at this issue of poverty and environmental degradation. Look at the linkages and do something about it.
Do you have the right mindset regarding the environment?
The right mindset, of course, yes. I think we have problems as a country, but there are solutions.
What are the solutions? Do we have the structures? Have we begun to move?
We have the structures, and as part of our elaboration of the achievements, we have the structures, we have the institutions, we have the legal and policy frameworks. In fact, on the other pillars of the environment, of sustainable development, we've performed quite well in the view of the surrounding circumstances.
Which ones? Explain to us.
Especially the social and economic pillars, things like life expectancy, things like
running
literacy.
Away from the environment.
Not really, because we are talking about sustainable development. We are not talking about the environment. The environment is just one pillar of the three pillars of sustainable development. I actually wanted to tickle my colleague here that the problem most of our countries are facing is because we continue to think in boxes. The people in the environment are talking to themselves, but they don't run the whole show.
That's the correlation.
Yes, the people in the economy, finance, and so on are also talking their things, and it is a trap. You come to a talk show, you talk about your area, your environment, and that's why you are trying to drive me. But I think sustainable development should look at a more balanced and integrative way.
No, are we doing the right things? Are we as a country, are we doing the right thing? Do we have the right mindset?
We have the right mindset.
Are we developing there are challenges, sustainably?
There are challenges, there are difficulties. I don't see any government that doesn't want its people to live the next day. I don't think
Mr. Kamese,
so. It's just
do we have the right mindset within government?
I think we did have that kind of mindset, but eventually we are running away from that thinking. And as I said, and I must say it again, we are talking about three pillars, but they are pillars that are looked to be more powerful than others, and therefore when you talk about issues of that's why even NEMA is failing.
Oh.
Because Yes, I was. I'm also going
to
I'm tickling him to say it. But NEMA is failing because there are people within that think environment is not a very important aspect of sustainable development. And once you have that kind of thinking, then all the other pillars they may show some positive trends in the beginning, but eventually they will reach somewhere they will be constrained, and that is the dilemma that we are having. In as long as we have people who are looking at the NEMA as noisemakers who are there and who are not supposed to touch on developers, because there is a thinking once investors must not be touched.
Yes.
Even if he's coming to sell pancakes, he's an investor and he must not be touched. So that, if we continue having that kind of thinking and say these one or two pillars are important than the other, then we are going in a wrong direction. And I must say
it all begins at NEMA.
Eugene, I must say that we as environmentalists are not alarmists. We are not. We know that even myself, I don't want to live a poor life. But I also know the child that I'm bearing today has a right to a good environment tomorrow. And that's why we are motivated to say, no, look here, we need to develop in the right way.
But you didn't support green accounting.
Yeah, green accounting, I said, when you reduce it to economics only, then there we part ways. But if you look at it in a more balanced way, then we go together. So that is where our center of disagreement lies.
All right, let's hear from the listeners. This is Spectrum Radio, and tonight from Rio de Janeiro to Kampala, what lessons has this country learned to protect the environment and also deal with challenges that frustrate sustainable development? You can call in now on numbers 0414-348-111, 0312-260-390, 0312-261-390. When you call in, please tell us your name and where you are calling from. I'll give the numbers again, 0414-348-111, 0312-260-390, 0312-261-390. Spectrum, hello?
Hello?
Yes, sir, your name? Devo, yes? Can you lower the volume on your radio, Devo?
All right, I'll do that.
Where is NEMA indeed? They are in Jinja Road. Mr. Muramira, you have very nice offices in Jinja Road. You find it tempting not to, you know, it's better for you to stay there rather than go out and defend the environment.
That's absolutely untrue, and quite a correction on that. I was very balanced.
Okay, let's take another call. Spectrum, hello? Yes, sir, your name? Yes, John.
From what I think we
Okay, let's get back to Mr. Muramira.
Yes, I was trying to point out that when I talked about poverty, I was very careful, especially for Kampala, to point out that the situation is quite unique, that we see a lot of rich people actually contributing to degradation. Some of the people who are in the wetlands are not very poor people, and as the caller pointed out, if you want to agree with him, some of the industrial pollution is from rich people. But the poor also don't escape the net, because as I did mention, we've seen them in the slums, we've seen them in growing, you know, yams and things like that, and degrading the environment.
The poor grow. You really have a thing to grind with the poor people. Let's hear from you, Mr.
No, I think this is also yet blaming the wrong people. I have...
The poor destroy the environment by growing yams and sugarcane in the swamps.
At least when you go to the wetlands, you would rather have yams than having somebody carrying trucks and trucks of maram and dumping it there. I have traveled around Uganda. I have seen a lot of forests that have been cut by the rich. I have been in Kalangala, for example. A lot of natural forests, trees were cut and trees were made to rot, very big trees. So for example, palm oil trees will last for about 30, 40 years. What happens? What happens to that environment? So I think we are blaming the poor, yet the person, because for some of these people, what they are doing it, and eventually I think it is the rich pushing them into these kind of environments. And once they are there, the next day they are pushed out, and you see a mansion coming up in the wetland. We have seen many houses. The other time, take for example the Luzira wetlands. How many poor people are involved?
Building French cut houses.
Building French cut houses.
Even the architecture is a bit strange.
So I think, yes, the poor have a stake, but we have lived with poverty for a very long time, and yet the environment was not being degraded as fast as it is now. So I would take a minute to blame them so much. Yes, they are contributing, but not as alarming as we think they are.
Maybe I can build my point. Okay. And one of these days someone should write a book on the environmental history of this country. I was a young man in the early 90s, and I would walk to Chambogo sometimes, that place where you see Cardi.
You were a young man in the early 90s, go on.
Yes, I'm still a young man. Now, Chambogo, that whole place you see Cardi were yams. My axe to grind with whoever was there is that if you do environmental historic analysis, these are the guys who alerted, the rich guys you see there, that there is a place to go. In fact, there is an emerging partnership between
the rich and
the poor and the rich. You might have noticed a pattern. I don't know if it is organized, but the poor enter a place. They colonize it with yams, sugar cane.
Then the concrete follows.
They sell. And I think they shouldn't be, you know, patronized, the poor, the victims, and so on. In many places, they have alerted the rich guys that there's land here to take, and they have dealt deals. They should be equally blamed
Mavira
with their
forest.
Police, their
Mavira
richer
forest.
Colleagues. Mavira? Fortunately, that's no longer an issue now. Maybe we should skip it. Because
let's talk about the action points from Rio, Mr. Muramira. What action points do we have?
Okay, those of you who must have listened to the Honorable Minister's press statement yesterday, she clearly pointed out a number of steps government is going to take to absorb, uptake, and implement some of the good ideas the delegation picked from Rio. She has actually commissioned a working group, she calls it an interim working group, which is going to develop a concise concept paper with comprehensive mechanisms and the proposals on how we will integrate sustainable development goals into national development policies, strategies, plans, and programs. Participatively do consultations reflect back to Rio, reflect back here, understand our problems as a country and tailor them. I should mention also that whereas there wasn't a lot in terms of, you know, partners, the contributions we should expect from Rio, some countries promised some support. Japan, for instance, has developed a program, or is going to develop a program on south, would that be north-south cooperation and support in the area, which is very pertinent now in view of the catastrophe in Duda on disaster risk reduction. As you know, they had this terrible Great Japan earthquake, and they have geared a lot in understanding this problem of natural disasters. So they have developed a program and dedicated resources to help the rest of the world in understanding and forestalling disasters. So Uganda and the relevant personalities should prepare to benefit from this. Now, I've talked about the concise concept paper. This paper will be translated into a cabinet information paper, which should advise government and cabinet for that matter on what steps we should take as a country to implement the proposals in the outcome document, which, as you know, we pointed out at the beginning, has the theme of the future we want. The future we want is a prosperous, secure, and good future. Not the future of landslides, not the future of flooding, not the future of deforestation, and so on. Right. We are really committed as a government to achieve that, and that's why the minister has swiftly moved to put in place. You know, some people go to conferences and come back here and sit, but you must appreciate the minister is not even 2 days back here, but she's already taken all these steps.
All right. We congratulate her. Thank you very much, dear guest, Mr. Eugene Muramira, Director Policy Planning and Information at NEMA. Thank you for coming to Spectrum tonight to open our eyes to who the real threat to the environment is. Thank you very much. Mr. Geoffrey Kamese, Senior Program Officer in charge of Energy, Climate Change and Chemical Management. He comes from the National Association of Professional Environmentalists. Thank you very much for coming tonight, sir. Thank you for tuning in. I've been your host, Edmond. She's the Spectrum. We'll be back tomorrow. Right now, you can hear the news in English.
Patrick Chikomeko is a sales director. Patrick works with dozens of sales executives and managers in Uganda and abroad every day. Patrick thinks